Before you run off to tell everyone about the magical powers of your favorite Taylor Swift song, you should know that there are downsides to this connection too. For instance, have you ever made a dumb decision at a nightclub? Anyone? Maybe in terms of making new friends? You know, listening to sounds at volumes over 95 decibels can actually reduce your mental and physical reaction times by 20%. And club music usually plays at about 120 decibels. Louder music actually tends to increase alcohol sales in bars too. So really, it wasn't your fault. Everything was stacked against you. You know, what's crazy is this stuff is all happening at a physical level. It's affecting our actual brain chemistry and body functions. But we don't know why exactly. Music therapy is a field of study that's popped up recently to research and document these connections and a ton of others, including music as a painkiller and as a possible way to kick addiction. Some of it seems a little spacey, flaky, maybe, but you can't deny that the connection is there. What's the biggest way that music's helped you in your life? Let me know down below and subscribe for more D News.
So I just want to shoot this question out there, right? Knowing the fact that when music is played over 90 decibels, your cognitive functions slow down. Should liquor stores, bars, nightclubs be responsible for your actions if you were to go home with the wrong person? If you were to get in your car and drive drunk, should they be held accountable for the decision that you quote unquote made, with them knowing the science of it all and knowing that them by playing music and serving alcohol can possibly have you in a bad situation? Do you think it's the club's owner's fault or is it yours?
I think although there is an influence with the sound and the drinks there, ultimately we make decisions for ourselves. So I think we should be held accountable for what we do to an extent, because sometimes there's things that happen that are out of our control.
Okay. Anybody else? Can I get one more person?
Thanks. I was just going to say that specifically in cases where you're paying to get into a club and paying for the alcohol, you're kind of inherently consenting when you give them your money. You're making an exchange. Like, you're consenting to the fact that you're now liable for the alcohol and like what happens to you. But I think it could be slightly different if it's offered to you for free and entry is free. So.
Okay. And there was one more person who wanted to comment.
Mine was pretty similar. I was going to talk about how you're consenting to be in the bar and anything that's happening to you there. And as far as like making a dumb decision by like going home with someone you regret in the morning, etc. I think that's too high up in cognitive processing to blame on them.
All right, cool. Even though they're slowing it down, they're slowing your cognitive processing down. Because they know the sign.
Yeah, I think it's still too right. High of a decision. It's not like a subconscious kind of deal. Well, it is and it isn't.
I got you. I want y'all to keep that in your mind, though, as we go through this. So tell me this, guys. What's the most listened to genre of music globally? So we have country. We have rock with Marilyn. We have EDM. And we have hip-hop rap music. Which one do you think is the most listened to genre of music globally? And I'll take three points. Just shout it out.
I'm gonna guess rap and hip hop.
Yeah, I'll guess rap too.
Okay.
EDM.
EDM. Okay. Anybody else? We gotta get one more. All right, three.
I think hip hop and rap too.
All right, here we go.
Yeah, I would also say hip hop.
Hip hop. All right, cool. Thank you guys.
I let my tape pop, and if I hit the switch, I can make the ass drop.
And you don't stop.
And you don't stop.
Never eat your pig, cause a pig is a cop.
I got the rap patrol on the gap patrol. Ladies love me long time like Tupac song.
Like bro, like dough, like dro, nitro.
And if you don't know, now you know.
You know I got soul.
In my 6'4".
Oh snap! Guess what I saw?
Standing on the front stoop, hanging out the window.
Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the door.
I jumped out the rock and said, "What's up?"
Designated driver, take the keys to my truck.
Pauline in my
nice, split the blunt up.
Come on, everybody, let's get
the fuck up.
Man, what y'all wanna do?
Yo, what you wanna do?
What you gonna do?
Wanna be a baller,
be ballers, shot callers.
I wish I had a girl who looked good, I would call her.
Holla.
I was like, good gracious, ass is bodacious.
And I approach baby like,
hi, my name is
last name ever, first name greatest.
I've been spending hundreds since they had small faces.
Yeah. See notes by the layers. True fucking player.
Bass in the space means peace. See you later.
Funky fresh and yes, cold on my feet.
My life's like a soundtrack I wrote to the beat.
When the streets keep calling, heard it when I was sleep.
T-O-M-P, T-O-M, my city mobbing in the street.
This is my part, nobody else speak.
Okay.
First, let me hop out that chopper sister, brother, son.
Showstopper, flow, proper head, knocker, beat scholar.
Girl, I want a waller in the back of my Impala.
I know you ain't a pimp, but pimp, remember what I taught you.
Who am I? I'm the boss.
I still represent with your house.
I go, go.
Two shot biggie smalls. If we don't get them, they gon' get us all.
Hey, you know how we ball. Right in the shiny car.
I'm the regard for the law. We dodge them like fuck them all.
Smoking hot, throwing up. Keeping lead up in my cup.
You leave no drink around me, but leave your drink. Gon' get drunk up.
It wasn't even close to Halloween
when the MCs came. Tell them about the name.
Went solo on that ass, but it's still the same.
Okay, first things first, I'll eat your brains.
Eating whack rappers alive, shitting out chains.
Westside, when we rock, come equipped with game.
Look, homie, what? I done came up what? And I ain't good. Changing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
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 Hold up. I don't mean to hold you up, but I got something to say.
Come on.
Give me the mic so I can take it away.
Player haters, get away, or my leg will spray.
Cause this type of shit, it happens every day.
And I will never stop.
Because I just can't quit.
Mayonnaise, color bands, I push miracle whips.
I gather around, I'm the new fool in town.
I'm the young Harlem nigga with the Goldie sound.
Get down, down.
When I came to get down.
Get down, girl, go ahead, get down.
I get money, money I got.
Rock the needle that'll make.
I told you I'm just like a clock when I tick and I talk.
It's to the beat, y'all, and it don't stop.
What I'm talking about, y'all, is hip hop.
So hip hop is the most listened to genre globally in 2018 and earned 901 billion streams. So my question to you guys is, after watching that video, what is so hypnotic about hip hop that it has taken over the world? You got to think, it's only been about 44 years at this point that it's been around. So in 44 years, it's taken over the music industry everywhere. So in your opinion, why do you think it has become such a dominant player in the music industry?
I was just going to say, I think it's because people can express a lot of different feelings through this genre. Like, I know there's people that can talk about struggles they're going through or how they made it out of the struggle, or like situations they're in now, what it's like at home to how they got to where they were. They can tell a story in all different ways that can relate to multiple different people and types of people so that everyone's able to listen to it.
Gotcha.
Excuse me, Mr. Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot to remind you. Could you start recording so I can send it to my other class?
Okay, I'm recording.
You started from the beginning?
Yeah, a little bit after the beginning, but we got it though. We're on it.
Okay, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
It's all good. Anybody else? Could I get one person?
I was gonna say, because of the hooks, they say like really creative lines that are easy to like get stuck in your head compared to like maybe other songs. Like other songs don't have the beats maybe to like make some hooks as catchy.
All right, cool. Got you. Thank you. Here we go. So the question of this whole lecture today is this: does hip hop music / culture influence youth to commit violence or use drugs? I should have drug use, but you get it. Does hip-hop music slash the culture influence youth to commit violence or use drugs?
And now, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, me personally, no, but as a vast majority, I think yes, because we're talking about in class on Tuesday how a lot of the Black rappers, the Black male rappers, they use rap as their outlet of their emotions and feelings, because in society, it's frowned upon for them to express themselves in any other way but a specific thing. So I think in rap, when they're talking about drugs and sex and money and all of that stuff, violence, it tends to rub off on the younger generations and kids. And also the visuals, once you see these kinds of music videos and whatnot, the youth and other people start to, they see these things and they kind of see it as, this is what it's supposed to be, this is cool, I want to do this too. So I think in a way it does influence the youth.
Okay, anybody else?
I'm gonna disagree. When I look at it, I think the same can be applied to movies, video games. Like, you could say the same question, like, do violent video games or, you know, like war movies, action movies, horror movies, things with a lot of violence in them, do they incite violence among individuals? And I think it really comes down to the person, not so much the population as a whole. I talked a little bit about this in the discussion, but if an unstable person is to listen to hip hop or rap with violent lyrics, so to say, then yes, they might commit an act of violence. But I think the same goes for if they were to watch a violent video game or movie, I think they'd be encouraged to do the same things. On the other hand, if a person with a stable outlook on life with their stuff together, so to say, they won't commit an act of violence, and it would go the same if they watch something violent on the TV. That's kind of what I think.
All right, cool. Now I want you guys to hear from some more of the professor type guys. Here we go. Check this out.
Up next, a tribute to Pop Smoke.
Talk about violence. Here we go. Travis Scott, the Pop Smoke. Go, R.I.P. Pop Smoke. Yeah,
my name was actually Papa, so the homeboys didn't want to call me Papa, so they called me Pop, and it just mixed the pop with the smoke, and it just came as one.
She like the way that I dance, she like the way that I move, she like the way that I rock, she like the way that I... Let me see some.
Shoot for the stars, you right? Aim for the moon.
My bitch love Coco. Woo back, baby. Woo back, baby.
And so we're going to move on to some of the more theologians. You'll hear them speak, but the reason why I showed this guy, his name was Pop Smoke. He was recently murdered. Hip-hop star on the come up. And when the young lady was speaking about the visuals and things of that nature, I don't know about you guys, but as a kid growing up, I felt as though, and this is just my opinion, and everything you all are sharing, it's no right or wrong answers. I believe that we share each other's opinions so we can kind of sculpt our own, you know what I mean? But the one thing I will say is this, when I see him on stage, when I was on stage, and you see all of those people looking at you, you feel important. Why do people suffer from all of these new diseases of wanting likes? People want to be noticed. It's just an opinion. But I'm not saying yay or nay towards the fact that does music happen? Do the visuals? I can't say. But I do know one thing. people want to be noticed. So what will you do to be noticed? Here we go.
Of the debate, and we know that if you're easily shocked, you probably wouldn't be here or be listening. So now please welcome our advocate for the motion, Eamon Courtney. He'll make the case against hip-hop. Eamon, you have 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Emily, and good evening to one and all, here, there, and everywhere. It's going to be a wonderful evening. And let me start by disappointing you. I am not an expert on hip-hop. He is. Professor Rose is. We have artists here who know more about this than I do. But I am here as a father who was taken to a ludicrous, or was it ludicrous, concert by my 16-year-old daughter. And when she came out and told me, "Daddy, Daddy," she sang a song, he sang a song to me, and I said, "Which song?" She started telling me the words, and then she stopped and couldn't finish. Hip-hop does not enhance society, it degrades it. I am not going to debate the history of hip-hop. I am not going to say that it did not have a great and glorious past and a beginning. Of course, Rapper's Delight. Of course, Public Enemies. Fight the Power. Listen to this poetry. As a rhythm designed to bounce, what counts is that the rhyme's designed to fill your mind. Now that you realize the pride's arrive, we got to pump the stuff to make us tough. Beautiful, but it is no more. My friends, I have 4 minutes, but I want to invite you to join me very quickly in a place called Hip-Hoposphere. A place called Hip-Hoposphere, a parallel universe, where bad is good, where wrong is right, where crude is cool, where asses are more valuable than brains, a place where the thugs are the kings, and a place where bitches and hoes take pride of place. Something is wrong with Hip-Hoposphere, and there are people here who love that place. I don't. And I'm inviting you to reject it and to vote against it tonight. There is this idea of swagger. I'm sure that the professor is going to tell you about it. What is it? Swagger. It's obscene. It is about the idea that money is the main thing. Let me tell you what 50 Cent said. Get rich or die trying. That's what he said. Let me tell you what else he said. Death gotta be easy, because life is hard. In Hip-Hoposphere, the idea that you go to prison is glorified. 50 Cent, Jay-Z, Lil Wayne, each and every single one of them is a convicted criminal. We need to reject that idea and reject it firmly. But my friends, the reason we're here is this: the power of hip-hop. It's attractive, it's seductive, it's addictive, but it's toxic. And it's that toxicity that's killing us, that is killing our young people, that is killing the older people. And when I say killing, I mean K-I-L-L, shooting. And listen to the words of the hip-hop people. Listen to what they say to you. "I got an itchy, itchy trigger finger, nigga, it's a killer. In me not to spray that shit. I got enough ammo shots to blow eye up a hole in every motherfucker out this bitch. I be a gangster, a nigga till I die for sure, whether I am poor or filthy rich."
10 seconds.
Isn't that gutter? Isn't that obscene? Isn't that a sick culture? I say to you, reject it. I say that is degrading the society in which we live. I say it is bad for you, it is bad for me, and it is bad for all of us. I have 5 final points to leave with you very quickly. This whole idea, it first of all promotes thuggery and criminality. It fosters misplaced values. It is designed to appeal to the base in our society. And I say to you, if hip-hop does not reform and reject this, its future has passed. I thank you for your time and attention.
Eamon, thank you very much. Thanks for kicking us off so forcefully. Please now welcome the advocate against the motion, Michael Eric Dyson, who'll be making the case in favour of hip-hop. Michael, you have 4 minutes for your opening address.
I want to thank my distinguished colleague, Brother Eamon. I've rarely shared the stage with a real lawyer, a real barrister. In my neighborhood, barrister is how you said bastard with a lisp. So good to see him here today. Does hip-hop degrade society? People say that because, as my colleague said, it leads to crime. Do you know crime has declined dramatically in the last 20 years? Murders are down, assaults are down, robberies are down, rapes are down. There is no one-to-one correlation between a hip-hop lyric and a subsequent material condition that leads to criminality. That's a mythology. Now, what the criminologists tell us, there is a reason, there's a perceptual gap between what we think and what is the case. That's because of crime shows. It's not T.I., it's C.S.I. Get it right. Then we talk about education. Education is in shambles, but not because of hip-hop. Hip-hop teaches a respect for rhetorical genius, for oratorical wizardry, for the invention of words. But material conditions lead us to budget shortfalls, which keep instruments out of schools. If we want young people to play instruments like Questlove, if we want young people to be able to engage in the most sophisticated classical extension of traditions that have been nurtured both within the heart of Africa and in the heart of Europe, then give them access to the money. Stop the budget shortfalls and give our children access. Also, of course, they talk about incarceration. Most young black and Latino men in America, and unfortunately even in Europe, especially in the UK, are there for nonviolent drug offenses. It was not hip-hop that led them there. Before hip-hop was even invented, there was an over-incarceration of African-American and Latino men. It has only been exacerbated by repressive white supremacist practices of both Europe and America. Has hip-hop grown out of degradation? Of course it has. In the late 70s and in the early 80s, with the rise of Reaganomics, Reaganeering, Reaganopia, as Charles Adams would say, there's been a destructive political concentration upon demonizing young black men and increasingly women. Those are state policies and public policies designed to corral young black people. Has hip-hop sometimes glamorized and glorified that? Of course it has. But it is a complex culture which shows the ludicrous character of trying to assault an entire culture that produces both Jay-Z and Nas and Lauryn Hill and Questlove and Eminem. How can you assault a culture that is already critical about itself? How can you be against something that's against itself? It already encourages self-reflection. Unlike my colleague, who had nothing but self-righteous condescension pointing the finger at the other side, hip-hop says, as Lauryn Hill said, even after all my logic and my theory, I had a motherfucker, so you ignorant niggas hear me. Jay-Z said, all my teachers couldn't reach me and my mama couldn't beat me hard enough to match the pain of my pop not seeing me. So, with that disdain in my membrane, got on my pimp game, fuck the world, my defense came. Self-criticism, looking at their own culture. Biggie said, back in the days, our parents used to take care of us. Look at them now, they're even fucking scared of us. So, there is self-criticism. And as I end, will you destroy an entire culture because of some problematic pathological expressions that are undeniably wrong? Misogyny, sexism, homophobia, they're all in the church. Are you going to stop the church? Are you going to get rid of the church? You're not going to get out of the church, right? Finally, let me say this. My colleague says it appeals to the base element. It does. Base, how low can you go? Base.
I would like to open that up for any opinions on the advocate for or against. And I would love to hear, let's say, two or three thoughts about it. Do we have any people who are for the advocate for hip hop or an advocate for who are against hip hop?
Say something about the person who was against hip hop. You can tell he was some form of West Indian, whether he be Guyanese or whatever. And I thought it was ironic that he was talking about the hip hop culture and how it's promoting drugs and violence and things of that nature, when West Indian music is centered around the sexualization of women. Mm-hmm. So I thought that was interesting. But I like, he kept pointing out how they were talking about drugs and violence and all these other things, but they're talking about a struggle that occurred because of the situation that they were put in. If there wasn't systemic racism, if it wasn't difficult for them to get an education, it was difficult for them to get money, they wouldn't have to do the things that they do now to make money. Because if he could have, if the person who's rapping, let's take NBA Youngboy, for example, this man dropped out of college, dropped out of high school in ninth grade, has no education, lacks vocabulary, all of these other things. Why did he drop out of school? Because it was difficult. He needed to make money to support his kids, right? If it was easier for him to obtain a job, if it was easier for him to stay in school and still make money, he wouldn't have to rap about drugs and this and that and the next thing, calling females B-words and all that other stuff. So I think that's interesting.
Okay. Anybody else?
I think that you can kind of compare it to like how people are looking at police officers right now. Like there's those few bad apples. Yeah, there's some rappers that come out and they only talk about drugs and sex and all this and that. But then we forget to look at the rappers. Like I said in my discussion board, I know that Lil Baby just had a song that speaks solely on the corruption in America against Blacks and the killings of Blacks. And I think that people forget that they're using their words for speaking where they can't and for the people that can't, because they get looked at where like they're not able to say because they're getting suppressed by the system.
All right, cool. Anybody else who would like to share? Can I get, if you want to, if not, we can move forward.
Yeah, I would like to share. For one, I just wanted to note that we can't use the police department as a similarity to rap, because for one, they have they were made with two different intentions, one to uplift and another to suppress. And also I wanted to speak to the fact of the person who was speaking in favor of rap, what he said when he said we conflate all of rap together. And it's interesting because it's not coincidental that rap is scapegoated, and it's also a genre that is predominantly used and like taking place by people of color. And I want to say that before we started, it is important to understand that there's different subsections of rap. There's gangster rap, and then there's rap that like Public Enemy and Lauryn Hill, the Refugees, that they use as a point to uplift the people, speak to the struggle, and also use as a tool of like kind of radicalization and abolition.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yeah, so going off of what I said earlier, because I know I kind of made it sound like it was a general thing for rap and its influence on the youth. Like Maya was saying, how there's different like subdivisions of rap, how there's gangster rap and all that stuff. I still think, you know, of course, the visuals and what the youth are seeing, there is that part of it that they do get influenced by, but there's also so much more and such like uplifting. Like there's the part of rap that's very uplifting, that's informative, that's relatable, that, you know, that you can really feel. So I think I definitely agree with the person who was advocating for rap, because there's like in the lyrics and the, it's a form of poetry. There's the people who talk about their struggle and the way that they put it together. It's something that I think is beneficial for the people. And despite all of the negatives that happen, overall rap, it's really something that it's good for the people. So yeah,
cool, Well, thank you all for sharing. And then we're going to move forward. And as we talk about anything, if I were to ask you who you are and what you are and where you came from. Where did your family come from? How did you start? That's the origin of self. You know, you can't help me if you don't know who you are. Knowledge of self is key. So I just wanted us to take a quick look at the history of hip hop and where it came from.
I ain't no joke. I used to let the mic smoke. Now I slam it when I'm done and make sure it's broke. When
hip hop created a musical landscape in the 70s and early 80s by giving New York or the Bronx, especially the Bronx, a musical foundation or a new start, because we were just coming off the 60s where the entire city was bankrupt. That environment kind of gave birth to hip hop. Hip hop is a culture based on four foundational elements: DJing, MCing or rap, graffiti, and breakdancing.
People use the terms interchangeably, rap with hip hop, whereas hip hop is the bigger culture. Rap is something you do. Hip hop is something you live.
Coming from the disco era, you know what I mean? We were inner city kids. We couldn't get into discos, so we had to recreate that disco. And that's what basically hip hop started out as, like the bastard child of disco. I mean, it was our rebellion against that and our recreation of it at the same time.
You see, I am Wonder Mike and I like to say hello.
The turntables became our instruments. Like, so a lot of people in the inner cities, they didn't have money for instruments. So you had to find those sounds somewhere. So you dug through your pop's Cradle Records and you just listening for these different instruments and sounds, and then you pull from those different sounds and made a total new creation. People forget that the DJ is the backbone of hip hop. That's where it all started. DJ spinning at parties.
Kool Herc is actually documented as the father of hip hop. When he was playing the type of music he was playing and maybe the way he was playing it, it brought out a different type of energy than ever experienced from that demographic at that time.
And he just started putting one drum break behind the next drum break, and you would just go to Herc party just waiting for those breaks. On the beat.
B-boy and B-girl comes from Kool Herc. B meaning break, okay? Break boy, you dance on the break. That's it.
It all ties into dancing and really going off during the break beat of a song at a party back in the days.
And then there was different parts of the record where you could talk over it and then the beat's still going, but you don't lose the attention of the record or the main part of the record. That evolved to MCs getting on the mic and just saying things to keep the party going, which evolved into actually rhyming and rapping, because these different MCs will have little sayings that they said.
Party people, if you're ready to rock, let me hear you scream.
A teenager named Africa Bambaataa started the Zulu Nation at the Bronx River Projects. It was a new type of gang which focused in on music and dance.
Bambaataa was the first guy to say, hey, let's all come together. You can all play on my set. So he was integral in uniting hip hop. And in 82, when Planet Rock came out, became a universal hit. That just added to his prominence and his outreach to the rest of the world. The connection between hip hop and graffiti, it's an urban thing. Though it was here before the actual rest of the elements of the culture, the people involved in graffiti were directly involved in hip hop as well.
Bad Five Freddy was the bridge between hip-hop and graffiti. He brought the South Bronx and the people from Harlem downtown to where the hipsters and where Keith Haring was and Madonna were hanging out. Before he was a DJ at Yo MTV Raps, he was a graffiti artist.
MTV made hip-hop global. It broke it out of being a niche kind of music or something like these black kids or Latin kids are doing in certain urban areas to an actual viable genre of music that reached middle America and mainstream America. Particularly Walk This Way was the record that took hip hop next level on MTV, man. That collaboration with Run DMC and Aerosmith was just perfect. That was really the moment that hip hop became global, and MTV played a big part in that. UK, South Africa, where, you know, English is one of their major languages. You see it in Brazil, you see it in Japan. You know, they're big into the culture, man. And you'll go to a concert in Japan, man, and they're rapping every word in English, and then they don't speak a word of English.
Hip-hop connected the world and music together. This is what The Score did. This is what Puffy did. Dr. Dre did some of this stuff too. That record that I've done for Shakira. Hello? It's hip-hop and hip-hop record together. You know what I mean?
I think institutions are trying to preserve hip-hop when you see places like art galleries, you see it in fashion, you see it in business. I think that's preserving hip-hop, even when people don't realize that's actually preserving it.
Welcome to Hutch Tours, the original and the only hip-hop sightseeing tour on the planet.
Hutch Tours is a hip-hop sightseeing tour based on the culture. It's guided by the pioneers of hip-hop, and we take people around the city to different places that were relevant to the development of the culture. Nashville celebrates country music. New York City needs to celebrate the birth of hip-hop.
We created something from nothing. And hip-hop was the first art form that spoke to me. People who looked like me, people I could look up to, the way they put these words together and tell these stories about places that look like where I live. And that's just like what hip-hop is all about. It's just evolving and staying ahead of the curve and being something aspirational.
Ladies and gentlemen, a masterpiece by Jean-Michel Basquiat. And I'm going to start the bidding here at $57 million. $57 million. $58 million now. $58 million. $59 million now. $60 million. Thank you. So Yuki's bidder at $68 million. And I can sell at $68 million. You want to bid, sir? $68 million. So Yuki's bidder at $68 million now. $68 million. Patty, you want a bid? Sure. So everyone this side of the room, it's Yuki's bidder at $68 million. And I'm going to sell it. Fair warning now. Last chance. Is that a bid, sir? $69 million. New bidder. Yuki, can we make it a rounder number? $77 million. $78 million now. $79 million. $80 million now. At $98 million. The hammer is up, sir. I'm selling it on this side of the room. It's Yuki's bidder. Fair warning. And selling, thank you, sir, for $98 million. Thank you, Yuki. Congratulations. Thank you very much. LO300. Thank you very, very much indeed.
And after taxes, it came up to about $110 million. So Jean-Michel Basquiat also was a part of, they consider him a part of hip hop, from New York, homeless, was living on the streets for many years and was a graffiti artist. Just goes to show you, it's not where you start, it's all about where you finish, right? And when you look at these guys on the street, when we look at these arts or seeing this demonstrative writings upon the wall, who knew if they just had more education, if they had more opportunity, if they had better schools, if they had dual parents, if they had a parent, you feel me? Where could they have gone? But sometimes in the middle of the madness, you can find genius. And that's what happened with Jean-Michel Basquiat. I'm going to start moving a little quicker through this. We will have some time for questions, but I just want to make sure that you get the meat of this. Here we go. Give me 1 second. I'm sorry. All right. So hip hop transitioned from a party and break beats to an area of hip hop highlighting social injustice.
It's like a jungle sometimes, it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. It's like a jungle sometimes, it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. broken glass everywhere. People pissing on the stage, you know they just don't care. I can't take the smell, can't take the noise. Got no money to move out, I guess I got no choice. Rats in the front room, roaches in the back. Junkies in the alley with the baseball bat. I tried to get away, but I couldn't get far. Cause a man with a tow truck repossessed my car. Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under.
And right there, when you think about what he just said, not like when I hear certain songs over and over and over again, doesn't that sound, that song sound so relatable to today? Aren't a lot of us on edge? I don't know if you guys saw the movie Unhinged yet, but when you do, when you do see it, people are on edge right now. It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under. So look how relatable that song came back out in 88, 1988. America was in a place of destitute. New York was a bigger slum than it ever had been. And when you go to New York now, it's very posh even in those places. Gentrification. When you look at them and talk about, you know, it's like a jungle sometimes. When he says, the junkies are in the back with the baseball bat. Where are we today with the opioid crisis? Think about all of these correlations that you hear in the music from so far ago, but so relatable to today. So these are some great storytellers of telling the truth. You're hearing their truth. Prior to hip hop, they said that the rapper was the person who, they were the news anchors who told the story of what was going on in the hood because everybody else was ignoring them. So let's just think about that for a second.
What do you think you're most known for? Your acting, your music, or the controversy that surrounds you?
My big mouth. My big mouth. I got a big mouth. Can't help it. I talk from my heart. I'm real. You know what I'm saying? Whatever comes, comes. But my controversy probably. And it's not my fault. I'm trying to find my way in the world. You know, I'm trying to be somebody instead of just make money off everybody. You know what I'm saying? And so I go down paths that haven't been traveled before, and I usually mess up. But I learn. You know what I'm saying? I come back stronger. You know, I'm not talking ignorant. You know what I'm saying? So I obviously put thought into what I do. So I think my mouth, my controversy. I have not been out of the paper since I joined Digital Underground. I've been in all, you know what I'm saying? It's never, my name has not been not uttered, you know what I'm saying? And that's good for me because I don't want to be forgotten. If I'm forgotten, then that means I'm comfortable. And that means I think everything is okay.
One day I'm gonna bust, blow up on this society. Why did you lie to me? I couldn't find a trace of equality. Work me like a slave while they laid back. Homie, don't play that. It's time to let them suffer the payback. I'm trying to avoid visible contact. I can't hold back. It's time to attack, Jack. They got me trapped.
It's interesting how hip-hop rap music in the beginning, or a song like Grandmaster Flash's The Message, where basically they were saying, you know, it's like a jungle sometimes. I wish, you know, I wonder how I keep from going under. The whole root of what that song was basically saying, look, these are the problems here. You know, and here we are 10 years or plus later. The problems are still there, and the intensity of the music has built to the no hope, the I don't give a... attitude. How did we get from Grandmaster Flash, the message, to where we are now in hip-hop?
Again, you have to be logical. You know, if I know that in this hotel room they have food every day, and I'm knocking on the door every day to eat, and they open the door, let me see the party, let me see, like, them throwing salami all over the, I mean, just like throwing food around, where they're telling me there's no food in here. You know what I'm saying? Every day, I'm standing outside trying to sing my way in. You know what I'm saying? We are hungry, please let us in. We are hungry, please let us in. After about a week, that song is going to change to, we hungry, we need some food. After 2-3 weeks, it's like, you know, give me all the food, we're breaking out the door. And after a year, and you just like, you know what I'm saying? I'm picking the lock, coming through the door, blasting, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you hungry, you reached your level, you don't want any more. We asked 10 years ago. We was asking with the Panthers. We was asking with them, you know, with civil rights movement. We was asking. You know, now those people that were asking, they're all dead and in jail. So now what do you think we're going to do? And we shouldn't be angry. And my raps that I'm rapping to my community shouldn't be filled with rage. You know what I'm saying? They shouldn't be filled with the same atrocities that they gave to me. In the media, they don't talk about it. So in my raps, I have to talk about it. And it just seems foreign because there's no one else talking about it.
Right. Well, playing devil's advocate, somebody might say, well, what does Tupac have? He's a movie star. He's got, you know, hit records. What does he have to complain about?
And I'm going to tell you. It's like being the last person alive. You know what I'm saying? After 3 days, you can't do anything. What can I do? Where can I go? There's no black neighborhood, you know what I'm saying, with black people who have the same amount of money as me. You know what I'm saying? There's richer and there's poorer. There's no just, you know, did a movie, got a little bit of money, living okay, black neighborhood. I have to be in a white neighborhood, so I don't fit in. That's hell. It's hell when you can't be around your peers. All my life I grew up around black people, poor people, but I can't live around poor people now because they'll rob me. And why would they rob me? Because they're starving, because there's no money here. But they're telling me, now that I made a little money, I have to move here. So it's not like no one's ever trying to deal with this section. They're just moving away from it. And we're gonna have more stars coming from together, but they're gonna all move this way. You know what I'm saying? So it's like all the society is doing is leeching off the ghetto. They use the ghetto for their pain, for their sorrow, for their culture, for their music, for their happiness, for their movies, to talk about boys in the hood. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to be another young. I don't want to be 50 years old at a BET We Shall Overcome Achievement Awards. You know what I'm saying? Uh-uh. Not me. You know, I want when they see me, they know that every day when I'm breathing, it's for us to go farther. You know, every time I speak, I want the truth to come out. You know what I'm saying? Every time I speak, I want to shiver. You know, I don't want them to be like, they know what I'm going to say because it's polite. They know what I'm going to say. And even if I get in trouble, you know what I'm saying? That ain't that what we're supposed to do. I'm not saying I'm going to rule the world or I'm going to change the world. But I guarantee that I will spark the brain that will change the world. And that's our job, is to spark somebody else watching us. We might not be the ones, but let's not be selfish. And because we're not going to change the world, let's not talk about how we should change it. I don't know how to change it. But I know if I keep talking about how dirty it is out here, somebody gonna clean it up.
Thoughts is a group on that. And I mean, look at the correlations of what he said. Years of tyranny in the black community, underprivileged. People still make it out of it. People make it out of hell. To become rich, but then become a foreigner. Can be stuck in Katrina and be called a refugee in America. Get pulled over by the cops, go through a same exact situation as somebody who's not my hue, who pops off more than me, gets to drive off, but then my wife is getting a phone call that I was murdered last night. Think about what he just said. That was 1994. Where are we today in correlation from what you just heard?
Almost in the same spot.
Okay. She said we're in the same spot, but how, but why? Because when you look at it, for me personally, in my opinion, I believe that social justice is something that needs to be revved up. And it's revved right now. The pedal is to the floor. And why I say it needs to be revved up, because voices need to be heard. When people aren't treated fairly, we have two sides. It's the people who think that that side is right and the other side thinks that side is wrong. But if everybody is just, if we start screaming so loud where we're, you know, blaring out each other, we are where we are now, we're stuck. You guys who are here are the future. You have your own opinions. I don't care if you're BLM or if I don't care if you're a Trumper. Either way, it's fine with me. The one thing I will say to you is this. Can you have enough understanding of a situation for you to be reasonable, to be marginable? Can we work together? Or are you just so far in your corner where you like, no, it's my way, it's no other way, it's a highway, and that's it? Because guess what, guys? At the end of the day, we're all Americans. So where do we find ourselves in this corner? But I think what Tupac said was just totally powerful, and I feel like the correlation is totally relevant. So, I mean, if anybody else wants to speak on it, please do.
I think what he was saying was exactly right. Like, we have been
like trying to voice ourselves and say, hey, like we want this to happen. And no one was listening. Been doing it for years and years and years, this peaceful expression, no one was listening. It was the same thing with how everyone was talking about how Colin Kaepernick, he was taking a knee. He was being peaceful. This man lost his well-being. He lost his job. He'll never be able to work for a football team again. He'll never be able to go back to the NFL. All he did was take a knee. But now that people are burning down buildings, it's, oh, why do you have to act like this? You can do it a different way. Well, you weren't listening when I did it the other way. So I'm doing what I have to do for you to hear me. When I mess with what you want, then you're going to listen. When I mess with your Target, when I mess with your Tiffany's, then you want to listen because that's what's important to you. My life wasn't important. Guess what? Now it is because I'm messing up your stuff. And I think that's very powerful. Like, I think we've been trying to be peaceful to please the white people for so long and they still don't care. They're not worried about what's going on in our neighborhoods. They don't care that kids still aren't getting food. There are kids going hungry for days and days. They don't care that there are people trying to get the education, move forward, can't do it. They don't care. So I think us moving forward more aggressively, I think that's what he was trying to say. He's trying to say people are being more aggressive. Things are different. Things are louder because no one was listening before.
And now one thing I want is, everything you said, I'm with you, I feel you, I feel your passion. But don't ever give a person, when you say it's white people, you know, it's some white people who are out here marching, getting their ass whooped, real rap. And they've been getting their ass whooped from 1965 all the way back to John Brown when he was running with Harriet Tubman. What I will say is, what about the system? See, it's different when you take your anger and point it at a person, but what if we all just took a look at the people who were pulling the strings and said, well, where did the system come from? How did the system come to be? How is it that generational wealth was held up through redlining, even though I may have had the money, but because I was Black, I couldn't move to a neighborhood to uplift my family and gain home equity, gain equity through home ownership, regardless if I had the money or not? Who built that system? Why can we both go in and get a house appraisal, but just because I'm Black, I get $100,000 left? This just happened. A young lady is married to a white guy, a Black lady. So she took all of the pictures down in her home. You can Google this. She took all of the pictures down in her home because when the appraiser came, when she was there, the house was worth $335. When she took all of the pictures down and her husband was home by himself, he got $480. Same house, same appraiser. Well, different appraiser, but almost over $100,000 more equity. Who built the system? That's what we're all fighting. Guess what? At the end of the day, a person who voted for Trump and a person who voted for Biden, guess what? We're still fighting the same system. So understand, you guys are going to be the lawyers, the doctors. You guys are going to be the social service guys and ladies. And you all are going to be the next wave of generation of people that's coming out into this world who are going to be quote unquote educated. But are you educated to pride, ego, or are you going to be educated to look at the system that has created this way of life for all of us?
Mary, let's do that last part because it's 3:30.
Got you. I'm sorry. Now y'all got me turned up. You feel me? No doubt. So there's so much that I like. So when we do the graduate class, we have a lot more time. We have like 2 hours. Mm-hmm. But I could talk to you about crack cocaine and how it came into our communities. But I do want you to hear this here. This is Nino Brown from New Jack City. If you never saw the movie, check it out tonight.
You're the one who's guilty. Lawmakers, the politicians, the Colombian drug lords, all you who lobby against making drugs legal, just like you did with alcohol during the prohibition, you're the one who's guilty. I mean, come on, let's kick the ballistics here. Ain't no Uzis made in Harlem. I mean, not one of us in here owns a poppy field. This thing is bigger than Nino Brown. This is big business. This is the American way.
I'm sure that the court was enlightened by your geopolitical tirade, Mr. Brown. Unfortunately, society at large is not on trial here. You are, Mr. Brown. Were you or were you not head of the narcotics consortium, the murderously bloody CMB?
Yes.
I could not hear you. Would you please speak up, Mr. Brown?
Yes, I was a member. But I was forced into this way of life. Hey, look, I've been dealing drugs ever since I was 12 years old. See, I didn't have the chances that you have, Miss Hawkins. I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth, Miss Hawkins. I mean, I wanted to get out.
And the reason why I wanted to play that for you guys is this. When we think of hip hop music, one of the biggest things that you see is that we self-medicate through what? Marijuana. You have more, if you go all the way back to the beginning when Michael Eric Dyson was speaking, he said you have more young black and brown people locked up for nonviolent crimes, marijuana. But now, as we look around the country, marijuana is becoming legal, but you still have people who cannot get jobs who are felons because of what? Marijuana. When they do it, it's good business. Like he just said, when you do it, you're a criminal. We have criminalized the generation. And I feel like when you watch the, listen to this music and listen to the stuff that they're talking about, all of this stuff correlates. And the last thing I'll do for the music part, that this will be the last one I want to show you guys. But listen to what this brother has to say, man. This was super powerful.
That play the role of hypersexualized, hypercriminalized male. I asked these advertisers, I say, I've got hundreds of songs a day that celebrate killing animals. Will you put them on your station? They said, no. I got hundreds of songs a day that talk about assaulting women and abusing kids. Would you put them on your station? They said, no. I said, I got hundreds of songs a day that talk about murdering blacks. Would you put them on your stations? They said, well, that depends. Depends on what? Who it's done by and who it's branded for. Because if we can get black folks to sing about it, and we can brand it for our youngest black audiences, I think there's money to be made. I think there's American appetites to see these people that way. I said, how can you say that? They said, well, look, it's what these artists know. It's what they, black people, create. It's, matter of fact, our surveys say it's what they want to hear, which speaks of a sickness. How do we live in a society where somebody says, you know what, I'm inspired to write a song that celebrates murdering another person. And then a person says, I'd like to put that on my station. Another person said, I'd like to pay for it. And then there's people out here in the audience that go, I'd love to hear it, as long as it's black guys. Because even white people buy rap music, buy this type of stuff, because we know that when we want to hear about killing each other, we know who to turn to for that type of inspiration. We call it our music. We say we own it. White people buy more rap than black people. Yeah, but we're very careful to turn it down at the stoplight when other black people are there. Why? Because we know we're just pretending for them. It's more authentic and real. I always ask the companies, what about your name? What about your brand? What about your value? And the largest radio company in the world said this, it's okay that we only have drug dealers on our black youth stations. We only have murders on our black youth stations. We support black charities. We give out water at the Martin Luther King Parade. I think we've got it covered. We've bought them off. Now, people get upset, the smartest guys in the room again. You're talking about censorship. I don't believe that. I believe in free art, make whatever you want. I believe you should make music about anti-Semitism. I believe you should make music about killing dogs. I believe in this country you should make music about bashing homosexuals and driving them behind trucks. I believe you should make music about stringing people up on trees. I believe you should make music about killing whitey. I believe you should make all that music. But I also believe that in the mainstream marketplace, people should hesitate associating their name with certain content. You know, there's certain stuff you can't buy at the store, certain stuff you can't get on iTunes because their brand doesn't want it. But if you want to hear black people celebrating killing black people, they got thousands and thousands and thousands of those things to sell you. I don't think it's about censorship. I think it's about American cultural hypocrisy. Because here's the truth. These black entertainers, they can't sing just about anything. There's some stuff that'll get them fired, and they get dropped, and they get fired, and they get slapped on the wrist, and they get disciplined all the time. Why? Because sometimes they step over the bounds. A very famous case is what happened with Rick Ross. Rick Ross is the Mammy Two Shoes, one of the many Mammy Two Shoes of our day. He's a black entertainer in a world carved out for him and a role carved out for him by white entertainment companies. And one day he talked about, in the middle of a song that celebrated dealing drugs and killing blacks, he made a reference to date rape. And when he made that reference to date rape, that set social media on fire. That got 100,000 petitions in 24 hours. Hey, buddy, date rape is no joke. That had white people standing outside of Reebok in New York saying, you better take this seriously. We're tired of a rape culture in America. One line in one song moved the masses. And you know what Reebok did? Did they stand by him and say, hey, we believe in freedom of speech. We believe in freedom of expression. It's just a song. Calm down. No, they fired his tail on the spot. The president came out and said, this goes against our high standards. He's gone against the values of our brand. Shame on Rick Ross. We're disappointed. He doesn't know how serious date rape is. And when I saw that, I thought, wow, how convenient. Isn't that amazing? But here's what really happened. It's not their brand, it's not their values. Rick Ross went off script. He was hired to get black customers, and they think that black customers go with black bait. And in America, black bait is the hyper-criminalized, hyper-sexualized portrayal of black people. And as long as he had sung about that, the stuff that got him hired, he'd still have a job at Reebok. But when he touched other sensitivities that affect us, he lost his job. See, the truth is, it's not they that need to change. It's we that need to change. We created the lies. We created them for our profit. We own the companies. We own the record labels. We own the advertisers, and we keep putting it out. And it's this that's got to change. I thought about it. You know what? I wonder if White Mike could get anybody's attention on this. So I stood outside of a Walmart, and I said, hey, I don't think killing cops and killing blacks is very cool. And you know what? It only took 7 weeks of Mike standing out there, and they wrote a letter and said, yeah, we don't think it's cool either. We're going to pull our name off of that. The largest retailer in the world had never considered that maybe their commercial shouldn't be right before or after a song about young black men being gunned down. And I realized this, that black murder is normal, but it should not be. And I realized the importance at the coffee table, at every headline, every pastor's gathering, every family gathering to say, you know what, these black lives matter. It's not just another black kid. These are human beings. I'm doing my best in every way, shape, and form. Talks like this everywhere I can go to say, you know what, I was born in a world where black murder was normal. My kids were born into a world where black murder is normal, but I don't want to die in a world where black murder is normal. Am I 5 years or 10 years away? I don't know, but I'm screaming as high as I can. Let's feel this pain, and let's lift our voice to tell the lies. They are not criminals, they are not deviants, and their lives are just as important as ours. Thank you very much.
And then, just to close, that with that, thoughts about what he just said, anyone?
I think it's the absolute truth. The fact that black people, they're expected to make a certain kind of music. And when it comes to them speaking on a certain thing or saying a certain thing, like with Rick Ross, that's when it's unacceptable and they lose their jobs and their careers over it. When in reality, it should be, they shouldn't be encouraged to talk about murdering their other black counterparts and whatnot. So I definitely agree with what he was saying with how black people are expected to make a certain type of music instead of, you know, being uplifted for the other kinds of topics that they discuss.
This is what Isabel Wilkerson was talking about in her book, Cast. There's certain things that black people are supposed to say, certain places where they're supposed to be, certain things they're supposed to do. And when they step outside of that, they're stepping outside of their caste, and they have to be put back into place. Let's close with one last one. Fallon, give me your opinions, and then we're going to close out.
I totally agree with what with Mercy just said. The part that he said at the end really stuck with me. Like, these are not just, like, yes, they are black people, and that is part of their identity, and black lives do matter, but these are also human lives as well. Like, they're not just part of an overarching, like, these people all have their own individual identities, and they're all their own individual stories, and each of these black people, like, their lives matter and their identities matter.
Thank you. Listen, class, I just want to say this. Any chairs that want to utilize the Zoom platform for meetings, because there won't be any more classes until December. If you want to utilize the Zoom platform, I will open it up for group meetings tomorrow and Saturday.